to this morning is from Matthew, chapter 16, verses 13 through 20. This is a conversation that Jesus is having with his friends. Now, when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others say Jeremiah, or maybe one of the prophets." And he said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." And then he sternly ordered the disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Bess, for helping us this morning with the reading of God's Word. And thank you to our choir. You guys, man, you sound just as good as you did when you left. You inspire us. You would think over the summer break, you know, that they might have lost something, but they did not. They sound as good as ever, so thank you for that. And thank you, Nancy, for your music this morning. Man, if I could sing like that, I would just sing my sermon, right? And you're glad I don't sing like that. We'll leave the singing to the choir and Nancy, okay? I promise I won't sing. Well, I hated pop quizzes. Did you just get a flashback when I said the word pop quiz? Remember back to those days? Now, some of you are still right there, still in class. But I remember whenever the teacher would say, "All right, students, pull out your paper for a pop quiz." I remember how the blood would just sort of drain from your brain, which is not good, right? When you're going to take a test, you don't need the blood to drain. Now, later in life, when I became a teacher, pop quizzes were my best friend. It's funny how life changes that way, right? But I'll be truthful with you. I did not grade pop quizzes. I used the pop quiz for me and the teacher, because the pop quiz could show me how much of what I had taught had been caught by my students in a way that an exam, an announced exam that the students cram for, doesn't show you. So I enjoyed these pop ungraded quizzes just to sort of take a, sort of like the way you check the oil with the dipstick, right? It just sort of gives you a reading about where the students are. And so as I read this passage that Bess read to us this morning, I think that's what Jesus is doing here. Jesus, the great teacher, is giving his followers, the disciples, a pop quiz. He wants to see what they have caught. And so he comes to them. You heard what Bess read. He asked them, "So who do people say that I am?" He's taking a poll, right? And they give answers. Some say you are John the Baptist. Remember, John had been beheaded because he invested his life in the kingdom of God, and it cost him his life. That can happen. Now, the prosperity gospel preachers don't tell you that. But the Bible does, that sometimes when we invest our lives in God's kingdom, it costs us our life. And that's what happened to John the Baptist, and that's why when Jesus came preaching, some thought this is the resurrection of John. It's John. He's come back in spirit. And some said he was one of the other prophets, or they gave their answers. And then Jesus came to the heart of the pop quiz. Hey, how about if we have a pop quiz this morning? Anybody want to play? Pop quiz. Who do you say Jesus is? Anybody want to play? Now, don't give me the Bible answer. Who do you say, Steve?
Son of God.
He's the Son of God. Anybody else want to play? Margie.
He's my friend.
My friend. Now, they're not actors. They are just normal people. They didn't know I was going to do this. Who wants to play? Who is Jesus? Let's see what our youth pastor says. This isn't fair, is it? But it's a pop quiz.
He's my father.
He's my father. Anybody want to play? We need a legal opinion, right?
The architect and guide of our faith.
Wow, he's been thinking about that. Who wants to play? Anybody? Janine.
He's my savior.
Awesome. I mean, I think we could go literally up and down the pews today, and we would get lots of good answers. My father, my friend, the architect, my savior. The truth is, we couldn't fully describe him, could we? But at any rate, when Jesus gave the pop quiz to his disciples, by the way, if you had an answer that you were just burning to give, email me this week and I'll send it out to the whole congregation, right? See how smart you are. But Jesus then posed this same question to his disciples, not who do they say, but who do you say? See, now it's personal. Who do you say I am? And you know how Peter, he was always the one who's jumping up. He's the student that's always, ooh, ooh, ooh. Peter says, you are the Christ. Now, we know Christ as part of Jesus' name, Jesus Christ, right? That's his name. But did you know that Christ is his title? It's his name and his title. Christ means the anointed one, the Messiah. In fact, one of the commentators said you could go through the Bible and everywhere you see Christ, you could insert the name Messiah and it still makes sense, still what it's saying. It is his name, it is his title, the anointed one. And Peter says, you are the Christ, the Messiah, the Son of the living God. And you know what? Jesus liked his answer. Jesus was impressed with his answer, gave Peter an A++ for his answer. And it was a good answer, wasn't it? In fact, some of you gave parts of that same answer. It was a great answer. I like the way that the message translates Jesus' response. After Peter has given this classic answer, right there on the spot, he hadn't studied for this. He didn't have it written down. Just right out of his spirit and soul comes, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus, in the Message translation, says, well done. You didn't get that answer out of books or from teachers. My Father in heaven, God himself, let you in on the secret of who I really am. He didn't get it out of a book. He got it as a gift from the Spirit of God. Now, full disclosure, just a few minutes later, Jesus is going to turn around and say to the same guy, the guy that he's just given an A+ to on the pop quiz, he will turn around a few verses later and say, you are Satan. You are a stumbling block. Get behind me. Same guy, a few verses later. One of the commentators says it's like falling at warp speed from the spiritual high to the spiritual low. Anybody relate to that? On the mountaintop with God, and then suddenly you're the stumbling block. I want to tell you this morning that Peter's answer was great, not because of Peter's IQ. I'm sure Peter was a man of average intelligence, maybe a little more, but the answer didn't come from here. It's not a product of his IQ. It is direct from God himself. That's what Jesus said. This is a gift from my Father. My Father has revealed this to you. And remember that James, the first chapter, 17th verse says, every good and perfect gift comes from where? From God, from above, from the Father. And think about it. This is pretty deep theology for a first century fisherman. To be walking around with this man, he's only known him for a short while, and to be convinced in his soul that in this man Jesus is the complete nature of the all-powerful Creator God. He didn't come up with that. in his mind. God gave that understanding to him. And so Jesus says to him, before the rebuke, Jesus says to him, "Well done. You are Peter." Now, there's a play on words here that we don't hear it in the English. It's in the Greek, because the word Peter, the name Peter, is Petros. And so he says, "You are Petros, and on this Petra," and both words are forms of the word rock. He says, "You are the rock," that's your name, "but on this rock I will build my church." It's a play in words, but it occurs only in the Greek language, and the truth is that Jesus was probably not speaking Greek. Anybody know what language he was probably speaking? Aramaic, or maybe Hebrew. And so this is a play on words that's crafted after the fact by the gospel writer. But Jesus is telling him, "On this rock I will build my church." And some have misunderstood that down through the ages. You know, the Roman Catholic Church understood that Jesus was saying, "Peter, you are the rock on which I will build my church." So what did they do? They made Peter the first pope. And there is an unbroken succession of popes. Peter the first. So they interpreted this as if Jesus is saying, "On you, the person, Peter, I will build my church." But I wonder if instead of that, if what Jesus was really saying was not on the person of Peter. I mean, just a few verses later, he's going to call him Satan, right? Not on the person of Peter. The foundation of the church is built on Christ alone. The scripture says this. And so what he was seeing in Peter was not his person or personality. He was seeing that kind of openness to the Spirit of God, so that God is able to give me whatever he wants to give me. If it is a great idea, if it is faith, if it is the gift of being able to teach or preach or to serve others, whatever God wants to give me, the openness to that gift, which Peter showed here in allowing God to put that thought in his mind, that's where the church is built. Not on a person, except the person of Jesus Christ, but on our willingness to open ourselves to him and receive whatever he wants to give. God is saying to us, I really believe this, that the church is built on the extraordinary faith of ordinary people. If you look at Peter, he was really just an ordinary guy, a fisherman by trade. Nothing spectacular about him, really, except this ability to receive what God wanted to give. And that is where the church is built, on the extraordinary faith of ordinary people. Who is that in your life? When I say person of extraordinary faith, who flashes before your mind? Who have you known? Who have you lived with that showed extraordinary faith? Wish we could take the microphone back around and hear some of those stories. That's how the church is built, on the faith of ordinary people. In my life, that person of extraordinary faith was my Aunt Wanda Knox. Wanda, when I went to college in 1980, I know I don't look that old enough to have been in college in 1980, but I was. And my Aunt Wanda was 30 years older than me, and she was a student there at the same college, Bethany Nazarene College, Oklahoma City. And we had some of the same classes together. Now, she had already had a whole career and was back finishing her degree, and I was just beginning. I remember one of the classes that we had together was astronomy with Dr. Emmert Hammer. And I was freshman on the back row laughing at Dr. Hammer because he was an unusual guy. And my Aunt Wanda, she's on the front row just absorbing everything she can learn. And at first I thought that's weird. And then I came to see that's her, that's Wanda. She's not here just getting a general ed requirement filled. She's here learning about this world that God that we believe in created. And so she's just like a sponge soaking all of this up from Dr. Hammert while me and my friends are laughing in the back. And one day Dr. Hammert was wanting to show us something about sound waves. And so he got the biggest rubber band I've ever seen in my life. And he attached one end of it to the doorknob of the classroom. And then he pulled the band across the width of the room, and he was making it wave, you know, like a sound wave does. And then he wanted to show how when you lengthen, and so he pulled it tight, and just as he did, it came unhooked from the doorknob, and it came flying across the room, and it hit Dr. Hammert right in the middle of his forehead. It was the greatest moment in that whole class. It was so entertaining. She was there on the front row soaking in. And I was in the back laughing. And I wonder, maybe that's why I look back to her as the truest follower of Christ that I have probably ever known. She and her husband in the 1960s went as pioneer missionaries. That means they were the first people from the Western world to go into a part of New Guinea. The people there had never seen outsiders before until they saw my Aunt Wanda and her husband, my Uncle Sidney. And they went there not to make money. There was no prestige in what they were doing. There was no political power. Nothing to gain except to serve God. And they went there and they served. And a year later, my Uncle Sidney was dead of cancer. And so Wanda came back to the United States. She had two small children. And while everybody was counseling her, you just need to find a job around here where it's safe. Aunt Wanda, she told me once that she believed that she had heard the audible voice of God telling her, go. Was she crazy? God doesn't speak audibly. Well, the person that I feel is the truest follower of Jesus I've ever known heard the word go. And so she went with two small children back to a primitive place. Craziness. Throwing her life away, some people said. But she went and she served. She had extraordinary faith, even though she was an ordinary person. I want to ask you this morning, is your faith prompting you to invest your life? Or is it just an opinion you hold? Do you see, that's the corruption of faith in our day, is that we've taken it to mean my religious opinions that I throw at people. Faith is not a religious opinion. It's not your idea about God. Faith is that you receive from God as a gift that drives you to invest your life for the kingdom. Or is it just an opinion for us? Opinions repel people. If you don't believe me, watch it happen on social media every day. Opinions distance people. But faith that causes us to invest in people, in service, in standing up for the powerless ones around us, that kind of faith, it compels people. It draws people in when we move from an opinion about God to an experience with God. Which is it for us? Romans, the epistle for today, the 12th chapter says, present yourselves as living sacrifices. You would think of a sacrifice as something that's dead or about to be dead. But this is a sacrifice that is alive. And Paul says, present your bodies a living sacrifice to God. That's investing. And then he says later, don't be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. This is Romans. And by the way, Kathy's going to be teaching Romans at the BSF, Bible Study Fellowship. She's teaching Romans. And if you're interested in that, talk to her or one of the other ladies that attend after the service. To be transformed by the renewing of our minds. I want to tell you this morning that God is still building.
Amen.
Jesus said, I will build my church and the gates of Hades or hell will not prevail. God is still building. And I don't mean a physical building of brick and mortar. I'm not talking about that kind of church. I mean God's people. God is still building His church, the church of people like you and I. We are normal, ordinary people, but when we receive what God wants to give us, and then when we share that, we are investing our lives, and God continues building His church. It's true here at Trinity First, and it's true across the globe. I want to tell you the truth that the United Methodist Church, and back in those days it was just the Methodist Church, the Methodist Church stopped growing 50 years ago. You can look up the stats for yourself. 1965 was the last year that the Methodist Church reported a membership gain in the United States. I was 4 years old. How old were you? 1965, more than 50 years ago, was the last year that the Methodist Church grew in our country. And since that year, every year since, we have been on a steady decline of membership. So can we say God is still building His church, knowing the statistics as we do? I submit to you that God is still building.
Amen.
In Africa, the church, the Methodist Church in Africa, is growing by 200,000 members a year. Why is that? I submit to you, it's because for whatever reason, they have found the secret of investing. They've moved away from faith as just a creed that we state, just an opinion that we hold, to a faith that they are receiving from God Himself, and they are investing their lives in such a way that the church is alive and growing. I want to submit to you that that is still possible here in El Paso, Texas, even in the downtown. People talk about it like it's a plague to be a church in the downtown. I submit to you, we've got people all around us who still need Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And we do too. And I submit to you that this place can grow. And I'm not just talking numbers here. I'm not talking about money here. I'm talking about the kind of spiritual growth that when it happens will draw others. They'll want to be a part of what God is doing, building His church, and it can happen right here.
Amen.
Did you read this week in the upper room about the lady and her fig tree? Anybody read that in the upper room? She had an old fig tree that stopped growing, and she thought it was dead, and it looked like an old dried up stick. And she had just about lost all hope for her fig tree. And then she noticed the tip of a green bud. Looked like it was dead, except that green tip of a bud. And so she began to water and to take care. And it started growing again. And it produced figs again. And she had almost given up hope, and yet was alive. I submit to you this morning, that's the way it can be. If we can receive from the Lord what He wants to give us. Jesus said, the gates of hell will not win. They will not prevail against the church. One of my seminary professors of New Testament, Dr. Roger Hahn, said, we think about that as if the church is being attacked by the enemy, by Satan. That's not what Jesus said here, is it? He didn't say that the gates of heaven are being attacked, he said the gates of hell will not prevail. That means that we are on the attack against the gates of hell. The church is on the offensive in the mind of Christ. Dr. Hahn said, the church charges into the very gates of death, rescuing the perishing and offering the opportunity for people to pass from death to life, just like the fig tree. That's us. We are supposed to be on offense, storming the gates of hell and rescuing those who are almost dead. In her devotional, the lady with the fig tree said this, "Nothing and no one is too far gone for God." Amen. Can I say it again? Nothing and no one is too far gone for God. That is faith. And when we live that kind of faith, it becomes building blocks that God will use to build his kingdom in our midst. We pray it every Sunday. May your kingdom come. My prayer for us here at Trinity First is that his kingdom would be built right smack dab here. Let's invest our faith. Amen, and may it be so.
Amen.